Good evening, everyone. I'd like to thank you so much for coming to join us this evening. We've been really, really thrilled with seeing how many people have been prepared to come and sit and hear from our experts tonight. And I'm really pleased to be your host for the next 90 minutes. My name is Zoe Kleinman. I'm a reporter at BBC News. And if you'd asked me this time last year what I thought the career-defining story of my generation was going to be, I would absolutely have told you it was Brexit. But it turned out that was only a warm-up, because if you think people get emotional about the European Union, turns out they get even more emotional about the prospect of a global pandemic. In January this year, I was reporting for the BBC from the US for 10 days. And when I came back, I sat in a meeting in the newsroom with some global news colleagues, and they were chatting about this horrible illness that had taken hold in China. And I said to one of them, what's going on with that, you know? And he said, oh, I think it's peaked now. I think it's on its way out. And I said, please don't say that, you'll jinx it. Well, guess what? I think he did jinx it, because 8 weeks later, I did my last shift in the BBC newsroom in central London. I've been back twice since then. And a couple of days after that, I got a call from a senior editor saying the BBC was getting together a coronavirus reporter team, and would I like to be on it? I said, yes, of course, when do I start? And they said, Monday. This was on Thursday afternoon. So I did start on the Monday, and I was immersed in a world of PPE and PCR and Nightingale hospitals. And I really did feel like I'd landed on another planet. And indeed, in a way, we all had. And then I started saying, you know, lots of people are talking about this weird COVID toe, this weird rash. Do you think we should be looking more into that? And then it was, a lot of people are saying, you know, that they're losing their sense of taste and smell. Do you think that's a thing? And then as time went on, you know, a lot of people are saying they're not getting better. I think their long COVID is looking like something we should explore. And I've stayed with the story as it's evolved and changed. It really is astonishing when you look back over the course of a few months how much we have all learned about COVID-19 and its impact on people, because there are so many different ways in which it affects their lives. I couldn't have done my job without the constant help of experts who are immersed in this, who understand viruses, who understand epidemiology, who are across the data and are, you know, so able and willing to give their time to help all of us to understand more about what's going on around us. And it really is a privilege to have so many top experts here tonight. I have to say it's a first, even for me, to have them all on Zoom in my front room. Without further ado, I'm going to hand over to them. They're going to have 10-minute talks each. We're not going to let them go in for longer than 10 minutes. I was going to hire an orchestra to interrupt. Turns out it's not very easy to do that. So it'll be me banging a metaphorical drum, I'm afraid. But I will try and keep things to time. Now, the important thing is there's a Q&A box, which you should be able to see at the bottom of your screen on this Zoom call. If you have any questions at all for any of our experts, or indeed a general question you'd like to ask, please stick it in there. And at the end, we're hopefully going to have about half an hour for questions, and I'll get through as many of those as I can. So please sit back, have a cup of tea, and let me hand over to our first speaker. It gives me great pleasure to introduce Dr. Michael Head. He's Senior Research Fellow in Global Health, and he's going to be speaking about splashing the cash in infectious disease research. Dr. Michael Head.
Thank you very much indeed, Zoe, for the introduction and for agreeing to chair the session tonight. I hope you can now see my slides. Let me just put them full screen. There we go. So yes, I'm based in the Clinical Informatics Research Unit at the University of Southampton. And this is just a brief sort of summary slide of some of the units that we have. We do a lot on data management, health informatics, clinical trial management, governance, that sort of thing. My area is looking at how we spend research money, or that's one of the projects I do. And we recently looked at how we spend $105 billion of research money from public and charitable funders, specifically on infectious disease research. And we're also tracking the spend on COVID-related funding as well. This is the paper we published in Lancet Global Health about 2 or 3 weeks back. And the link is there as well. And this is one of sort of the key summary slides from that paper, $105 billion by year. And you can see that since 2006 or thereabouts, funding for infectious diseases has been on a decline. To a certain extent, that makes some sense, because there's less infectious disease around the world than there used to be. And non-communicable diseases like cancer or stroke or diabetes are very much on the rise. But clearly within that, there are these sort of sudden outbreaks. We think of bird flu or swine flu, and this pandemic is going to cost trillions. And if we'd invested a few more billion in terms of pandemic preparedness, we probably wouldn't be in quite the situation that we are now. We looked within the data set at bugs and how much we spent on each, and about 0.4% of the data set was spent on coronavirus related research. And if you look at that by year as well, you can then see that the funding basically correlates with public health outbreaks. SARS in 2004, and then the MERS Middle Eastern Respiratory Syndrome coronavirus in 2015. So we don't fund things in advance, we fund things when they happen. Similarly with Ebola, about 1% of the overall 105 billion was spent on Ebola related research. And you can see here that when the public health emergency happened in West Africa in 2014, that's when the funding was pumped in. There was very little in the way advance. And similarly with Zika as well, we crunched the numbers there. And you can see that all of the funding basically was from 2016 when Zika virus first started emerging in South America. So only Zika was a bit of an unknown. I think many of us were Googling it just to try and work out what it was and where it had come from. But Ebola and coronavirus were sort of known entities that could cause high threat outbreaks. But we didn't do too much in the way of too much research in advance. With regard to COVID-19, we have been tracking it across the year. And thus far, we've tracked about $3.3 billion worth of funding for coronavirus-related research. And we will update on that link there over the next 2 to 3 weeks. We'll probably be about $4 billion by that point, I think. And this is already much more funding than all tuberculosis, HIV, and malaria research combined in 2017, which was the most recent year of our big data set. So the research response has been huge and very, very intense. And much of that funding that we've been able to detect has gone towards vaccine-related research. I'm very much looking forward to Professor Forst's talk later on about vaccines, just to hear more about it. But certainly if we do end up with a successful vaccine candidate or a few candidates soon, then it will be in part because of the intensity of research that's been put into that particular area. It's been a priority for many funders. There has also been a decent chunk of money also for the behavioural and social sciences research. So looking at why people fund research, looking at why people behave as they do during a pandemic, looking at knowledge and attitudes, how you translate new knowledge from research into policy and practice, that sort of thing. There's several hundred studies focused on that. So this is kind of a scene setting talk, so to sort of summarize on that, we in the global health world are reactive. For example, funding is pumped in when there's a problem, but not really beforehand. We've demonstrated that with Ebola and Zika and coronaviruses. Pandemics do provide some fantastic opportunities for researchers to step up, which is partly the sort of motivation for running this webinar this evening. And exhibits A to F are essentially going to be my sort of fellow speakers following on from me here, really. But ultimately, it would kind of be nice if we didn't have to be here to do this. A proactive horizon scanning approach about what's coming next is crucial and has really been, to a large extent, lacking. But preparedness, that's the key word. The world is clearly not ready for a pandemic. The UK is not ready for a pandemic. And preparedness does include a certain amount of research in advance of that. I'm just going to give a quick shout out to some of our global health research. And you're actually going to hear more of that later on in this session from Dr. Ken Braxton. But it's also likely a late shuffling of speakers a little bit. So Ken stepped in at the last minute. Very thankful to him for that. But we have research ongoing in West Africa, in Ghana and Togo. And I know that we have some Ghanaian colleagues online tonight, so you're very welcome. But also one of the things I've done in the pandemic is work a lot with the media and the public. And part of that is countering misinformation or setting the sort of the story straight a little bit. And I'm going to highlight one particularly volatile topic at the minute, herd immunity, which essentially is where you just let the virus run through a population until you're all immune against it. And that's been reported in some places. There's a split between scientists as to whether this is a good idea or not. I think I would argue very strongly, actually, that there is not a split. The consensus is very clear that herd immunity is not a viable strategy. And there's just a few outlier scientists who are promoting this viewpoint. Just to illustrate that, I just mocked up this graph, basically. I think if you put expert opinions on a graph, it would come out something like this, really, with regards to herd immunity. Most of us are going to be somewhere in the middle. We've got a good idea of the knowledge base, the evidence base, and roughly what we should do next. We do mostly agree with each other on the whole. And there are those few outliers on the top right corner of the graph who are proposing something different. And when you have a data set with outliers, they're certainly interesting to look at, interesting to poke and prod to find out why they're there. But they're rarely actually useful for sort of implementing knowledge into policy and practice because they're unlikely to be right. And I think here with herd immunity, I could have put in any number of examples or quotes, but I'll link to the World Health Organization here. They described attempts to reach herd immunity as scientifically problematic and unethical. But that essentially is me done, sort of just to lay the scene a little bit for my fellow speakers to follow, just to acknowledge speakers, chairs and attendees. Many colleagues within CIRU, particularly Beth Geeler, Tim Bell and Gary, have put in invaluable support, and numerous other colleagues across the university and my global health colleagues too. On the right-hand side of the screen, there's various links towards me, but essentially there, I will stop and hand back to Zoe. But thank you for listening, and thank you, Zoe.
Thank you very much for that, Dr. Michael Head. We've already had some questions come in, so please keep them coming. Don't forget there is a Q&A box at the bottom of the screen where you can put your questions. We'll get through as many of them as we can. But let's get on now with our next fantastic speaker. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Nisreen Alwan. She's Associate Professor in Public Health, and she's going to be talking about inequalities and long COVID.
Thank you so much, Zoe. I'm going to try and share my screen. So, hi everybody, I've got 10 minutes to talk about the massive areas of inequalities and long COVID. So really just a few highlights. Thank you so much, Michael and the team, for inviting me to take part. So when this pandemic started early in the year, people were actually talking about COVID being the great equalizer. You know, everybody could get infected, we're all susceptible to the virus, whether you're rich or poor, whatever background you're from, it's an infectious disease, it could, affect everybody. Very quickly, we realized that that's not the case. COVID is not an equalizer. In fact, it's a big divider. It really did make the inequalities in health and disease in death more pronounced. We saw more and more of them and how the factors shaping them, including social, economic, environmental factors, you know, have a big play in this pandemic. And just to go through some quick examples, really, this is from, some data from England back in May, looking at infection rates in people. So we can see here that people living in the most deprived neighborhoods are almost twice as likely to get diagnosed with COVID. And you can think of lots of reasons for that. You know, people were unable really to protect themselves during the pandemic, had high risk jobs with lots of exposure, unable to kind of perhaps have adequate PPE, crowded households, you know, crowded neighborhoods, all sorts of factors where you would think of why this is the case, but also, you know, people already, there have been inequalities before COVID, so people have lots of health risk factors who tend to live in most deprived communities. And this sadly reflected in deaths from COVID, and you can see here the difference between kind of the most deprived and the least deprived. And then we come to ethnic inequalities. Again, that was a big story a few months into the pandemic. People from ethnic minorities were really having a much more likelihood of dying from COVID-19, but also in this graph from dying from other causes during the pandemic. So we've got excess mortality. This is really comparing mortality during the pandemic to baseline in previous years from 2014, 2018. And there is an increase in all ethnic groups, but very, very much pronounced in people who are Asian, Black, mixed, and other ethnic groups. And this is for men, and that also is for the case for women as well. Even though we know that women are less likely to die from COVID-19, but also huge inequalities in terms of ethnic and the ethnic, you know, ethnicity in terms of risk of death. And these are the sadly, these are the faces of the doctors who died of COVID-19 during the pandemic. Many of them are also from ethnic minorities. So that's mortality, that's death. What about morbidity? What about ill health? The story started emerging about the long haulers, long COVID, people not recovering for weeks or months after getting COVID-19 infection. And this picture really illustrates the wide range of symptoms people are experiencing as part of long COVID. Now, I was ill with COVID-19 symptoms in the second half of March, and I was one of these people who never really fully recovered. I would have periods where I would feel better, you know, being optimistic, almost back to normal. But then it hits me again, and it kind of, it comes and goes. And there were lots of anecdote people around me talking about their stories on social media about being long haulers. But actually, with my epidemiology public health hat on, come the summer, I started thinking, well, nobody's measuring this. You know, what's happening? No national surveillance system are measuring illness from COVID-19 in any sensible way, or in any way, really. So I wrote an article, the BMJ opinion in July, saying we must really measure long COVID. We must measure this. We must quantify this problem. We must know the prevalence of people who don't recover from COVID-19. And it doesn't look like it's a black and white picture where you either die or go to intensive care, or you just have a very mild flu-like illness for a few days. There's something in the middle. And then I followed this up in August with a piece in Nature, really kind of expanding and saying, we need to define recovery from COVID. It's not just about testing negative after positive or about discharge from hospital, but it's really about, understanding what recovery from COVID means, given the fluctuation and the relapsing remittent nature of the illness that seems to be that I experienced and other people with long COVID also experienced. So we're now trying to collate some of the prevalence figure to try and quantify long COVID. The figures really vary between 10% to 50%, depending on the type of study, the sample, the timing of the study. What I started there really had a positive effect in terms of generating specific interest into trying to quantify the problem, because we don't quantify it, we don't know who's vulnerable to it, we don't know the amount of resources needed to tackle it, and also we're not really given the message to the public in terms of the risk of catching COVID-19, so that they have an informed, some information about making their risk decisions. So basically, we're also doing a survey to try and characterize recovery in terms of what does that look like from a patient point of view. There was an editorial, recent editorial in Nature saying we must help, define recovery and incorporate patient perspective and how that looks like. This is a new illness altogether. And also with some academic colleagues who also experienced long COVID, we were saying, long COVID really is a good name for now for this condition, because it's a humble name. It just basically saying it's long, people are not recovering, we don't really know the exact mechanism of what's going on, and it might be more than one mechanism underlying it. And in social media started this hashtag of count long COVID. We need to have quantification of the problem, like we're quantifying deaths and quantifying positive tests. So that needs to be a metric of the pandemic as well. Sorry, going back here. So is long COVID the great equalizer? Very little data now, but I think are very unlikely. Some data emerging, very initial data emerging, saying it might be women are more likely maybe to get long COVID. Again, need to understand this mechanism, but also it's about all these people, with long COVID. It's about, again, it's the same factors: who gets to rest after having infection, who gets sick bay, who gets who can afford to stay off work for a while, who can not do that and have to put food on the table. So again, all these factors playing out in terms of getting prolonged illness from COVID-19. And just to really to finish and then link to what Michael said around herd immunity. Recently, I was part of a group of scientists. We published in The Lancet something around the scientific consensus on the COVID-19 pandemic, saying really we should effectively deal with this pandemic now is to reduce community transmission, because one of the reasons is long COVID and inequalities. We can't let the infection spread in the community without knowing the long-term effect of this virus, even in people who are healthy and of younger age groups. So really the message is, if we don't protect everyone, we protect no one. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Nisreen Alwan. We will be coming back to you later. Don't forget, you can keep putting your questions in the Q&A box at the bottom there, and we will come to them all at the end. But let's move on to our next speaker joining us now. Please join me in welcoming Jessica Floyd. She's Senior Research Assistant in Statistical Analysis and Disease Modelling, and she's going to be looking at predicting the movement of people intercepting the virus.
Thanks, Zoe. Thanks everyone for coming. Today I'm going to be talking about the impact of coordinated COVID-19 exit strategies across Europe. And the map here, which I'm going to talk a bit more about later, is predicted population movements around Europe before the pandemic started. I'm from the WorldPop group, research group at the University of Southampton. We're an applied research group that mainly focuses on mapping populations around the world to ensure that every person is counted in decision-making processes. We use open data and open peer-reviewed methods, and we have special expertise in spatial demographic data for low and middle-income countries. We use these data for key applications in areas such as epidemiology, that I'm going to talk a bit about today, but also maternal and newborn health, childhood vaccination campaigns, and so on. So managing COVID-19. We're all interested in exit strategies, and today I'm mainly going to be talking about non-pharmaceutical interventions, or basically things like lockdown that reduce movement in amongst the population. These include things like school and work closures, stay-at-home directives, self-isolation, and so on. In May and April earlier this year, national lockdowns were implemented across Europe and brought case numbers very low in a number of countries. These lockdowns and movement restrictions were eased towards May and July. And we asked ourselves, can we relax with numbers so low without expecting a second epidemic? And unfortunately, it seems now that that's probably unlikely. One of the things, one of the key factors that are implicated in the resurgence of cases is international travel, and we know that reintroduction may occur to certain areas after restrictions are lifted. This map shows the destination of some of travelers from key high-risk cities in China at the beginning of the pandemic, and just demonstrates the global nature of movements in different countries. This also underscores the importance of coordination between those countries, because we want to avoid a situation of COVID-19 whack-a-mole, where cases pop up in some areas and are brought down by temporary restrictions, only to pop up again in places nearby. So we asked, how much better are regional outcomes if exit strategies are coordinated? So what are the costs and benefits of international coordination between countries? We developed a mathematical model to answer this, and we had three main objectives. The first was to estimate baseline movement across Europe before the pandemic started, so that we had an idea of what movements look like between these countries. Then we wanted to quantify the effect of NPIs, non-pharmaceutical interventions, on movements and contact rates. And then finally, we looked at simulating scenarios into the future of lifting these non-pharmaceutical interventions. And we looked at these in two ways. We tested what would happen if countries ended their restrictions, but one country ended earlier. And finally, we looked at a different scenario of synchronized lockdowns and easing of lockdowns, a sort of 3-week on and off cycle of these versus unsynchronized. We initially did this in Europe due to the data availability, but will expand in the future. So this map is baseline movement in Europe. It's predicted movements between different countries and different areas. The lighter colors show higher probabilities of movement. So you can see that, for example, Germany was particularly well connected before the pandemic. We built this using two mobile phone data sets, one from Vodafone, which had data from Italy and Spain on the probabilities of people moving, and one from Google, which was from smartphone users and gave continent-wide relative population flows. So that's our picture of baseline movement before the pandemic. Then we looked at using these data to compare movement before and after. And you can see that this chart shows a great reduction in movement on average across Europe towards the end of March compared to before January and February. This map here shows just how large those reductions in movements were in different countries. So at the end of March, which is where this snapshot is taken, you can see the largest reductions in movement were in Spain, France, and Italy at that time. For the simulations, we simulated cases going into the future, given the movement patterns seen in and out of lockdowns or movement restrictions. The blue lines in this chart here are scenarios where one country ended their lockdowns early, and the red line just shows when all countries ended their lockdown at the same time. And the most important thing to note here is that subsequent waves of the virus across Europe began earlier when particular countries didn't coordinate with others. So for example, France, Italy, and Germany are there, you can see much earlier resurgence of the virus. And this is because those countries are particularly well connected. The map here shows just how much earlier the second outbreak or subsequent waves occurred, depending on which country didn't coordinate. For example, if France ended its lockdowns early, we saw resurgence across Europe about 35 days earlier than we would have seen otherwise. For the second simulation, we asked ourselves what would happen if we did movement restrictions or lockdowns 3 weeks on and 3 weeks off for a total of 4 cycles from April onwards, or from the start of the simulation going forward about 6 months. And the really interesting thing here that we found is that if all countries in Europe synchronized these lockdown cycles of 3 weeks on, 3 weeks off, or however long they were, we saw in 90% of these simulations, community transmission was brought down to zero. Whereas in unsynchronized situations where half the countries were following a different pattern, we only saw community transmission brought down to zero in about 5% of the time. And it's important to note that this reflects local transmission only. Since cases will still be imported from other areas, this reflects the likelihood of reducing local cases to a low enough level that strong test and trace systems can catch importations before large outbreaks occur. So to summarize, we saw resurgence of the virus and subsequent waves occurring up to 5 weeks earlier if certain countries ease their lockdowns or NPIs before others. This amount of time, 5 weeks or however long it is per country, is extra time that could be used for expanding testing, track and trace improvements, developing treatments and vaccines, and just giving time for health systems to recover. We also saw that synchronized easing and reinstatement of lockdowns can end community transmission or bring cases down very low a lot of the time. And these results broadly apply to different regions, such as the USA and low and middle income countries. And in fact, recent research just published last week, such as this paper, also demands joint interventions for the suppression of future waves globally. Our next steps is ongoing on to answer similar questions and conduct scenarios in different contexts using global data, such as this that we have from Google. And if you'd like further information, please check out the paper it's been published in Science there, or have a look at the rest of our research on the WorldPop website, or feel free to contact me.
Thank you so much to Jessica Floyd for that fantastic chat. We're going to move on now to our next one. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Ken Braxton. He's a research fellow in psychology, and he's going to be looking at COVID-19 experiences in Ghana.
So before I get going, I just wanted to very start by quickly defining the word attitude. So what are attitudes, and where do attitudes come from? So an attitude is defined as a settled way of thinking or feeling about something, and it's usually something that cannot be changed very easily. So everybody has an attitude about almost everything, and they're usually shaped by people's past experiences. So attitudes change when people have had a positive or a negative experience with something, which forces them to adopt their way of thinking. Now, there's a reason why I included this slide, and I'll come back to it in a minute. But before that, I wanted to talk about a study that I've been working on during the past 4 months. Now, I've been attempting to understand more about people's attitudes and behaviours in response to COVID in African countries, and more specifically, Ghana. So Ghana has a population of over 31 million people. The first case of COVID was reported back in March. And since then, there's been over 47,000 reported cases, of which half were in the capital city of Accra. Now, relatively speaking, they are doing a bit better than other regions in Africa. But Ghana is a lower middle income country. And as a result of COVID, there has been severe negative effects on the economy and the people who live there. And as researchers, you know, we all want to help. And we wanted to help by building a better understanding of just how much COVID has affected people in Ghana. And this was one of the aims of the study, to generate useful data that policymakers in Ghana could actually use to inform decisions. So we put together an online survey, which took participants around 15 to 20 minutes to complete. And we asked many different questions, including, you know, how COVID has impacted people's finances, what kind of COVID preventative measures people frequently carried out, you know, how often they wore a mask in public, or how often they washed their hands. And we asked about people's knowledge of COVID as well, so what they thought it was, and also some mental health questions. So Facebook and WhatsApp are two very widely used social media platforms in Ghana. So the survey link was shared in WhatsApp groups, and it was also advertised via Facebook ads as well. So it was advertised on Facebook to males and females of all ages across Ghana. So we recruited online participants in early August, and it ran for about 2 to 3 weeks. And here's what our sample looked like. So we recruited over 3,000 Ghanaian residents, over, as you can see, over 60% were male, and there was a mixture of ages in the sample, but the mean age was around 29 years of age, so a relatively younger sample. So a third of them lived in Accra, and a majority, the majority had completed university education. So this was a predominantly educated sample. Around 13% had been tested for COVID, but only 2% of the sample had actually tested positive. Now, what I found interesting, quite fascinating, was that a quarter of the sample reported that they knew somebody personally with COVID, even though only 2% of the sample had tested positive themselves. So I'm trying to think about that a bit more and understand that. So over 40% of the sample reported being unemployed, which is a relatively high number of people. So one thing that we could not gauge is how many people became unemployed as a result of COVID. So we did ask the question, to what extent COVID has negatively affected their financial situation. So as you can see, 60% said that COVID had affected their finances a lot, or extremely, which is sad to see. So it's obvious that people, more people in Ghana, urgently need financial support over there. We also asked questions about their compliance to COVID preventative behaviours, so things like hand washing, social distancing, wearing a mask in public, washing down household surfaces, etc. And I've picked out the two most relevant ones here. So in terms of hand washing, since COVID, 85% said that they very often or always practiced regular hand washing. And over 90% said that they very often or always wore a mask in a public place. And this is quite a high figure, which is reassuring, but we need to be cautious of this finding, especially since we know that it's a predominantly educated sample who were mostly from big cities. So we might find different results in a less educated sample or in more rural areas of Ghana. Now, something else that I found interesting in this study were the differences in risk reduction behaviours between males and females. Now, females reported that they carried out risk reduction behaviours more frequently than men. And this was a very strong and statistically significant result. Now, this is supported by previous studies showing that men are more reluctant than women to wear personal protective equipment face masks, especially at the very beginning of the pandemic, where masks were becoming more compulsory. If I go back, right. Yeah, but previous studies have shown that this is because men are less likely than women to believe that they will be seriously affected by COVID. So men are more likely to possess the attitude that COVID is not something to be fearful of. And this was something that I found in this survey. So males were significantly less worried about getting COVID and less worried about their family members or friends getting COVID than females, which could be the reason why there are gender differences in the number of COVID cases. And this is found in Ghana as well, where almost 60% of COVID cases are male and 40% are female. So when we asked people what they thought COVID-19 was, most people were correct in believing that COVID is a severe illness transmitted between people. However, a small number of people still believe in conspiracy theories, in particular conspiracy theories that some of you may have even heard of yourselves. For example, a small number of people believe that COVID is a biological weapon designed by the government in China, or they believe that COVID was designed to reduce or control the population. And these types of beliefs are dangerous because they have significant, sometimes fatal consequences by, you know, making the believer less inclined to follow recommended health policies by authorities. So further research is needed to understand who are more likely to believe in conspiracy theories. But this also stemmed into the vaccine question as well. So if a vaccine for COVID became available, would you get vaccinated? And over 60% said that they would, 20%, almost 20% said they wouldn't, and 20% said that they didn't know. And this is similar in other international surveys as well. A similar finding was reported in a UK sample. So this clearly highlights the importance of the importance that health promotion campaigns and public communications will be in ensuring a high uptake of any new vaccines when they become available. Finally, with regards to mental health, these are the results of the question, how frequently have you been bothered by feelings of loneliness during the past 2 weeks? And over 50% reported feelings of loneliness at some point, with nearly 20% reporting that they felt lonely nearly every day during the past 2 weeks. But also in this sample, almost 90% reported that they use social media at least once a day, with 32% reporting that they use social media 8 hours a day or more, which I think is an astonishing amount of time to be spending on social media anyway. But these are more likely to be single, unemployed people who don't go to work, who are being told to stay at home all day and therefore don't have, you know, much more spare time on their hands. And it's clear that from this data, there is an association between the two and that they contain an effect on one another. So the next steps of this research is to share these results with policy and decision makers in Ghana. And we've already shared a report of the findings with the Minister of Health in Ghana, and we are doing more work on carrying on those conversations. But more research is needed, and we need to understand more about people's attitudes towards vaccines, who are more likely to adopt negative attitudes towards vaccines and why. And we need to explore more about the differences in attitude towards COVID. For example, looking at differences between city residents and people who live more rurally. And we need to find a better way of identifying and helping people with poor mental health. I think there's a lot more work to be done, and there's certainly a lot that we can take from this survey. Now, every single one of us has an attitude towards COVID. I do, and the people of Ghana who completed the survey do, and every single person watching this webinar right now has a particular unique attitude towards COVID. Now, this is the challenge going forward. The people who have never experienced COVID personally, either themselves or somebody close to them. The big question, of which I don't necessarily know the answer, is how do we change people's attitude that COVID is something to take more seriously? I think it's a learning curve, and I think we will get there, but the big question is how, and these surveys that we put out will help to bridge that gap. So thank you very much for listening, and apologies for the sharing of my desktop as well. So I didn't mean for that to happen. Thank you.
It was momentary. Thank you so much, Dr. Kent Brexton, for that fascinating talk. We're going to plough on now with our next speaker. This is Dr. Peter Lawrence. He's a lecturer in clinical psychology, and he's going to talk about something else which is very much in the news at the moment, and that is UK child and family mental health during the pandemic.
Hello. I trust you can all see my slides. Hello, my name's Pete Lawrence. I'm a lecturer in clinical psychology at the Centre for Innovation in Mental Health in the School of Psychology. So I'm going to be talking to you about children and family mental health during the COVID-19 pandemic in the United Kingdom. And in particular, I'm going to be talking to you about the studies I've been involved in, what we call the Co-Space study and the Co-Spice study, more of that to come. And as with so much work that we do, it's a huge team effort. So I've been working with people in Southampton, so some very keen and bright students, Professor Helen Dodd at the University of Reading, Professor Pravitha Patale at the University College London, and then a whole team of more people at the University of Oxford, led by Professors Polly Waite and Kathy Creswell. So I'm going to tell you three things. I'm going to tell you about the Co-Space study, I'm going to tell you a bit about our findings so far, and then third, how we're using our findings. So who's involved in this Co-Space study? Well, it's parents and carers with children who are aged between 2 years and 16 years, and who live in the United Kingdom. And these parents and carers have been completing monthly online surveys since March for the older children and since mid-April for the younger children aged 2 to 4. And why, which is a crucial question, well, what we want to do is to understand what it is that seems to be helping children's mental health not deteriorate over time during the pandemic. So what seems to be preventing deterioration in children's mental health? But also, we want to be able to use our findings, sharing them with organisations and policymakers, to be able to get the support to families that they're telling us they need, and to be getting the support to the right families who seem to be struggling the most. And so this evening, I'm going to be focusing on the Co-Spice part of the overall Co-Space project. And this focuses on the parents and carers of children aged 2 to 4 years. So what I might refer to from now on as preschoolers. So we've recruited our sample using various media and means, including social media, organisations supportive, such as the Mental Elf, which is excellent if you've not heard of it, and through the media, occasional written pieces or being interviewed on the radio and so on. So we've been able to recruit our sample nationally via these means. And just before I come to tell you a little bit about what we found, it's important that you know, although we have a large sample, so over 3,000 parents of 2 to 4 year olds began our study, and tonight I'll be presenting data from up to about 1,700 of them. But this sample doesn't represent what we might think of as the typical families we'll see throughout the UK. So we do have a fair bit, some diversity. We have not only mums completing the survey, which is what typically might happen in research involving parents, we also have dads, and we do have some diversity in our sample, but it doesn't match up with the diversity that we would see throughout the United Kingdom. So we have people from England, Northern Ireland, Scotland and Wales, but it doesn't match the national sample. So from April to May, so you might think of this as during the first lockdown, about 1,700 or so parents and carers told us the things that were the most difficult for them during the lockdown. And nearly three quarters of them said that the thing that was most difficult that they felt unable to do was to meet the demands of work, meaning the work of not being a parent, but employment, and looking after their preschool child. And any of you who are watching as parents or grandparents with preschoolers or young children in the family might well find that that strikes a chord with you, because yes, it's exceptionally difficult. We found also that the parents were telling us that the three things that were most stressful for them during lockdown were work, the amount of time their children were spending on screens, and their children's well-being. And that's something we're really following up in subsequent studies, because actually there's very little evidence to suggest that screen time by itself is associated with any adverse effects on preschoolers or children's mental health. But that's a different talk. Also, parents told us that during lockdown, they perceived that the most common worries that their preschoolers had were about being unable to see their friends and being unable to attend the usual sorts of social or sporting activities that they would do under non-lockdown conditions. And so now I'm going to tell you from about 1,000 or so parents and carers who completed the baseline survey, but then also completed a follow-up survey 1 month later between April and July. And you can maybe decipher from this graphic, but possibly not, that actually in terms of preschoolers' mental health, where we've examined symptoms in terms of problems with attention or problems with behaviour or emotional problems, there was very little change in that 1 month period when between people completing the survey at baseline and at their first follow-up. And there was a very slight improvement in attentional problems that parents and carers told us about in their preschoolers, but no real changes at the group level over time in behaviour or emotion in preschoolers. But if you look here, what we've done is break things down a bit to compare the children by gender. So the darker blue circles are boys, and the lighter blue circles are girls. And what you may be able to see there is that over this 1 month period, boys, their parents reported an improvement in the amount of problematic behavior they were seeing, and an improvement in their attention over this 1 month period. So perhaps some differences between boys and girls, and no changes for the girls over this 1 month period. And then similarly, if we break things down in a different way, where we look at those parents and carers who told us they were employed and compare to those who were told us they were not employed, you can see the employed, the light blue, in the no change in emotion score. So that's the left tile. The central tile, though, we see that actually an improvement in behaviour reported by employed parents, and a slight improvement in attention reported by parents who told us they were employed. So they're just some of the findings so far. But what's really important is how we use our findings, of course, and we make freely and widely available all our findings in terms of reports before we even get to submitting what we'd call articles to peer-reviewed journals. But if you go on the CoSpace study website, you'll find all the reports from not only the preschooler study, but the study examining the mental health of children of school age. But also we share our findings sometimes on the TV news or in the written media, and literally only today, I mean, you might be able to see here, Tuesday the 20th of October, headline on the Guardian webpage was scarred for life. And this was particularly referring to some of the work that's been done in the co-space study, led in Oxford by Professor Kathy Creswell. Also, we share our findings through webinars such as this, where we not only report our findings, but make suggestions to parents about what they might be able to do that could be helpful in the circumstances of the pandemic. And also we share our findings with in this COVID Minds network, which is a network internationally of all mental health, well, much of the mental health research that's going on examining people's mental health during the COVID-19 pandemic. And also, as I indicated at the beginning, we have been sharing our results with those who have the ability to bring about some kind of change and make policy, and our results fed into this recent report, this month's report, in fact, State of the Nation 2020, Children and Young People's Wellbeing. And what we're going to do next is to use our findings. So we have what we call these quantitative findings, where people have filled in the surveys and we can sort of work out numbers. But what we also want to do are what we call qualitative interviews, where, I mean, typically you might conduct them face to face, but at the moment, probably we'll conduct them through Zoom or Skype or something like that. But we're just trying to hear people's stories and try to understand, well, what has the experience been from you? And we really want to use the findings that we have, because we know we've heard much less from particular groups, including people from a Black, Asian or minority ethnic group, those from lower income households, single parents, key workers, and those children and parents or carers who themselves have mental health difficulties or physical health difficulties. So I think that's all I wanted to say. Thanks ever so much for joining us this evening.
Thank you very much, Dr. Pete Lawrence. You know what? That was the closest I've come to having to employ my imaginary orchestra there. You just about scraped in under the time, so thank you. We're going to march on now. Please join me in welcoming our next speaker, Professor Paul Elkington. He's Professor of Respiratory Medicine, and he's going to talk to us about the development of respirators for healthcare staff. Dr. Elkington, over to you.
Thank you very much for the opportunity to present this work. So I'm presenting on behalf of a big team of people, in particular engineers, but many other people in Southampton who have helped this project. And the origins were very much from the NHS. I was on call one night early in March when I was called and said, we've got our first positive case. Do you mind going and taking over the care? And so I went along early in the evening, and there was no appropriate PPE. And also the patient that presented in an unusual manner had been in the hospital for several days, and many staff were sent home for 2 weeks. And my thinking was, if this is the first admission to this hospital and about 20 staff are being sent away, there aren't going to be very many staff left by the time this pandemic really gets going. And then a couple of days later, I was having my training on donning and doffing PPE, which is where you put on and take off your protective equipment, and it struck me how wasteful and unsustainable it was. So this precipitated me to send this image to Hal Morgan, an engineer who I knew, who we'd written a few grants together, all of which had been rejected. But I suggested that, would it be possible to make a personal respirator, which is based on a fan sucking air through a HEPA filter, which is a highly efficient particulate air filter, which removes 99.9% of particles, powered by a battery, blowing the air up a tube into a tight-fitting hood. And it's important to say we haven't invented anything. These are available in the sort of research environment and also are used in sort of things like welding. But if you remember the sort of atmosphere in mid-March, you know, China had shut down. It was getting very hard to get hold of anything. I was saying, could we make this from components we can just get hold of in Southampton? And Hal put together a very impressive team of engineers. And this is the boardroom in Building 85. And within 2 days, they had gone around Southampton, collected various parts, some roofing felt, they'd taken apart things from their own households, they bought a sewing machine, and they started making respirators, and a combination of an array of engineering methodologies such as CT scanning and then 3D printing the connectors from the CT images. So by the Thursday they had the first prototype, which you see on the bottom right. And I went over with the test fit spray solution and put it on, and they sprayed it in, and I tasted the test solution straight away. So it was a terrible disappointment, you know, the filter had failed. But they took it apart and put in one of the filters, which one of the engineers had taken off his freezer because freezers have a HEPA filter, screwed it back together. We repeated the test and it worked straight away. So it showed that you could make respirators yourself in-house, and they are made by companies by 3M, but Germany had banned export of all their powered respirators beforehand in the end of February when they saw what was coming. So this was an early Southampton Perso respirator. So it's powered by 8 AA batteries. It has a filter which is highly efficient, and it runs for about 8 hours. It blows the air up into your hood. And we then proceeded to trials on the ward. So on the left is one of my clinical fellows, Michaela, who returned to clinical service for the pandemic, and she was one of the first people to be given the respirator. She wore it for an 8-hour shift, and then Rick, one of the engineers, who'd been up all night finishing it, had been sent by Howell to collect it. And there was a slightly awkward standoff because he said, well, Howell's told me I'm not allowed to let any of these out into the wild because they're only prototypes. And Michaela said, no, I'm doing a night shift tomorrow and you're not having it back. And that was sort of the degree of protection you feel you get, because the standard face mask, we all know, as you sort of talk and sweat, starts to develop leaks, and it's very uncomfortable to wear for 8 hours. So I resolved that by letting Michaela keep it in my office, and I took responsibility for it. And she wore that respirator for the whole of the pandemic. We trialled it across different areas of staff, and my consultant colleague Tom Daniels is very pleased because he, by his own confessions, got quite a big nose, and he fails fit tests on all respirators, so on all standard face masks. So he was able to actually return to work because he had something which was fit for purpose. We systematically collected feedback, and the thing I hadn't actually thought about, this was very much a protecting healthcare workers originally. So the patients prefer it because they can see your whole face. And so, you know, during difficult conversations, we can smile or we can show empathy and we can communicate much better. For staff, it's more comfortable and less claustrophobic than standard PPE. The filtration is highly efficient, and because it's held in the respirator at the back, it doesn't move, and so you don't worry it's going to fail. You're not constantly taking off PPE, so you can see more patients and almost return to normal. But there are downsides. It, you know, the noise and how you store the respirators are the main limiting issues. And, you know, as we move forward in the pandemic, I mean, the good thing is the respirators, because they're reusable, each person has their own respirator, it should supply for the whole, should last for the whole pandemic. And modelling depends on how much the FFP3 masks, which are the sort of highly efficient masks we would wear as an alternative, are costing, but probably after about 6 weeks it's become cost neutral. And the COVID pandemic is generating a huge amount of waste, and this resolves the waste. So we then moved into a slightly mad period, having proven that the respirators worked, of trying to secure all the parts, because China was still locked down. It was very difficult to air freight anything around. This was a picture from my clinical lead that she sent me as a text, because we were getting quite a bit of pushback from some departments saying, well, we're going against guidance. So her son had listened to her talking to her husband and did the Lego representation showing how we all needed a Perso. I was in charge of trying to secure some hoods. And so there was a Craigmore online, which according to their website had 200 hoods. And I ordered that on my credit card. Unfortunately, or fortunately, it turned out there was only one hood left. So it was credited back and we got that one hood, and that did give some useful reverse engineering. Alex Mant bought all the HEPA filters from John Lewis in Southampton on her credit card. And Howell ordered all of the fans you could from RS Components. And we were securing runners belts all around Southampton. In actual fact, we didn't run out of PPE quite. So perhaps we all just got it badly wrong. But if you remember the situation in mid-April when PPE was frontline news, it was very nice to know we had all the components to build a large number of respirators. It hasn't been plain sailing. For example, we had to show that it was possible to clean the respirators. So wiping them down with clean wipes, we show that that kills the coronavirus if it's on it. And if you put all your staff into a respirator, it does change the hospital somewhat. You know, there were sort of comedy jokes about everyone looking like nuns on the run. During the summer, there were sort of the standard sort of logistic challenges of getting the approvals through, but the first mass production respirator, the Perso 3, has now got through all the appropriate BSI and HSE approvals, and I think we've got a better hood design now, which is off-ear, so it makes communication better, it's quieter, you can use a stethoscope. And that's a picture of Lecture Theatre 2, which didn't cause some problems when the students were due to come back because all the Persos were having their lectures. But Bainham's, who are our industrial partner, have managed to move forward on that. It's still a very active project. So as the second wave comes, we need to sort of work out the best way of deploying these in the NHS and where they should be best used. We're continuing to lobby for wider availability within the NHS because of the advantages we see, but we're obviously biased. We're working to increase the manufacturing capacity, and the team have continued, the engineering team, we're now working on a Perso Mini for the care home sector because the average age, unfortunately, of people who have died from coronavirus is 82. So this is clearly where the greatest risk is needed, but it presents some different challenges. And we've set up a Perso DW site. We made all of the intellectual property available from the beginning. And so we've got Persos being made in Colombia, South Africa, and this is the Bangladesh Perso. And you can see from the information they set up that they have, apart from a battery life slightly shorter than ours, they've generated a very good respirator. And hopefully this will help keep healthcare workers healthy during the course of the pandemic. Anyway, thank you very much for your attention and for your interest.
Thank you very much, Professor Paul Elkington there. Paul, if you need any more Lego minifigures, please do shout, because my house is absolutely full of them at the moment. Now it's time for our final mini TED talk, if you like, of the evening. I'm very pleased to welcome Professor Saul Forst. He's the Professor of Paediatric Immunology in Infectious Diseases, and he is going to ask a question that I think is on everybody's lips. What's it like to run a vaccine trial?
Thank you very much, Zoe, and thank you, everybody, and thanks for inviting me. So I've been asked to tell you about how we've delivered the COVID-19 vaccine trials in Southampton. So just as a warm-up, if you like, you might be aware that the UK Vaccine Task Force, which is part of the Department of Business, Energy and Industry, so BEIS, not the Department of Health, have established a pipeline of COVID vaccine trials that we've begun earlier this summer, but has really started properly with commercial studies starting this month. And that's because post-Brexit, the government had to secure vaccine supply for the UK, and they've done that by supporting companies, by UK government taking the risk for the vaccine trial delivery. So we've got a series of studies based around different vaccine technologies that will hopefully ensure delivery of eventually licensed vaccine to the UK. So I'm going to tell you about the AstraZeneca Oxford trials that we started in Southampton earlier on this summer. I mentioned the Imperial vaccine trial that's ongoing, but Novavax is the first of the commercial studies that started, and then other companies coming down the line. And you can see the different colours here. The technologies that have been chosen to bring to the UK are different. So there's a very good chance that some of these trials will be unsuccessful, that vaccine won't work. But the UK has not put all of its eggs in one basket. We've got different technologies, including non-replicating adenoviral vector vaccines, so the Oxford vaccine and the Janssen vaccine. Imperial and Pfizer are mRNA vaccines, so messenger RNA, which is converted to antigen in the body and stimulates the immune system after conversion in the body. Pfizer's not being trialed in the UK, but is secured for vaccine supply if it becomes licensed. And then protein vaccines and inactivated whole virus vaccine, and also a monoclonal antibody, because actually for the at-risk populations, such as patients with cancer or immune problems, they might need to be given an antibody and not active immunization. So that's the pipeline that we're working towards. For all of these studies, the endpoint is symptomatic PCR positive COVID disease, i.e. Do people who've had the vaccine compared to either a comparator vaccine or a placebo get COVID? So, you know, ultimately, do the people who've had the vaccine get less COVID than people who've not had the COVID vaccine? And just as important, because this vaccine development is hugely quick compared to normal. Vaccines normally take 10 to 15 years from start to finish development. We're talking about less than a year still since work started on all of these vaccines. Very important, the co-primary objectives of all these studies are the side effects, which we know as adverse events. So monitoring these trials for safety and to make sure there's an acceptable safety profile, as for any medicine or vaccine. And it's important for everybody to know that no corners are being cut. Despite the speed, everything is being done according to what would be normal regulatory practice. So vaccine trials are really complicated. I'm not going to talk you through this slide, but if you come to take part in a vaccine trial, you have all these different visits at the top, and you can see the timeline. It's intensive for the first few months, and then it spreads out up to a year. And in some cases, the studies are going to go out to 2 years. And then at each of the visits, a number of different tasks have to be carried out, including checking people are okay, taking blood tests, checking immune tests, and so on, making sure physical examination is normal, and as well as giving the vaccine and making sure that that itself is given safely and with minimal risk. So this is how we did it. We borrowed the sports hall at the University of Southampton for the first period of our studies because we had to manage this in a pandemic with social distancing. And you can see this very, very big space. So we were able to have a circuit around the room of people coming in groups of fours, being explained about the vaccine, watching a video, meeting the doctors, the nurses, being given the vaccine and so on. And we ended up with two sort of plans of how to do this, a screening visit plan for days where people were coming to check all the procedures and to work out whether they could take part, because at the beginning we were trying to make sure that didn't have COVID and that everything was fine in separate visits to the actual vaccine visit. And then the vaccine visits themselves, which were a few days later, organized in a slightly different way, but had to be absolutely organized with military precision by our team. So overall, the phase one trial, the COVID-01 vaccine trial, started in Oxford in April. It's an extremely large phase one trial. Phase one trials are normally sort of 10 to 60 patients sort of maximum. This was 177 participants, and we vaccinated 158 over 2 days, or 160 total in Southampton. And then the phase 2-3 trial started up very soon after that, and we recruited all of the over 70-year-olds in the phase 2 trial in Southampton, so 240. And then for the combined studies, we would have recruited 887 participants in Southampton to both of these studies by the time recruitment closes in mid-November, because there's been extra groups added in for looking at different things about the vaccine as we've proceeded through the summer. So these trials relied on everybody collaborating, from the hospital and the clinical research facility staff, the biomedical research centre staff, the wider R&D trust staff of research nurses, the university, colleagues in the Faculty of Medicine, wider university operational teams, estates teams, the NIHR Clinical Research Network, and staff from other trusts, including Portsmouth and Solent, came to help us because we needed over 70 staff per day, including doctors, nurses, admin, quality assurance, laboratory staff. And this is necessary both to maintain the quality, but also to have that number of people coming through. And we had to borrow staff and make use of the resources because, of course, in the pandemic, the hospitals were also very full at that time and clinical care had to be maintained. By the time we moved out of the sports hall on September the 18th, we'd conducted 4,145 visits in the university sports hall, and the university needed the hall back for socially distanced teaching. We've been borrowing the wide lane conference facility for follow-up visits and doing vaccines in the research facility at the hospital for a month or two, and we're moving into a new venue in central Southampton in mid-November when it's ready. So back to the pipeline now, how do we move this forward? Well, the answer is we can't do this just in a few centres. This is national activity, and there's going to be, in the second wave, some regions are going to be really busy with clinical work, Others will be less busy with clinical and might be able to focus more on vaccines. And of course, vaccines need to be given before, if we can, before the second wave and third wave, if it happens, because you need to be ready and have people immunized 6 or 7 weeks, preferably 8 weeks, before people come into contact with the disease itself, so that you can actually mount an immune response and see whether the vaccine works. So we've got 18 regions in the country, 15 in England, 3, and then the devolved nations, Wessex, Southampton and Bournemouth, and all our partner organisations across, NHS organisations across both regions contribute to this activity. We've got no shortage of healthy adult volunteers. There's a national electronic sign up at the website on the screen. And the capacity for large scale recruitment involves, as you might imagine, huge amounts of coordination and governance, training of the staff, physical location, logistics. We have to have people on call 24 hours and be able to review and test symptomatic individuals for both immunology and COVID tests. And we have to be able to monitor subjects for infection in the Oxford trial, although that's so logistically difficult, the commercial studies are not going to be doing that. So looking for asymptomatic infection and testing people every week. And that's important for vaccine deployment, although it's very hard to do, because we don't know whether any of these vaccines are either going to prevent the disease completely, prevent severe disease, but allow transmission to happen, or actually stop transmission completely. And there'll be much research and work to do in the future to work out for the individual vaccines, whether they, how they work, and in combination. So this has given us huge opportunities, but also some threat to the delivery. We've established new collaborations between centres and research and NHS organisations. It really is cross-infrastructure activity, and built an infrastructure we hope might extend to clinical trials beyond COVID, vaccines and other types of trials, and being able to teach a large number of people how to do research who would otherwise normally work in the NHS. And we're enhancing our collaboration with pharma. This is threatened if there's a second wave, because we're going to need the clinicians to go back to the clinical services. We might need to redeploy some of the staff back to their other clinical roles. And everybody across the system, NHS or research, is exhausted at the moment. And it's really important we look after our teams and make sure people get to take time off, even if we're in a lockdown. So can we do this alone? We've not done this alone at all. It's not just the research system, both the university and the National Institute of Health Research staff have contributed enormously, but we've actually moved on and we're working across the system now, and we've had senior NHS support from the Hampshire and Isle of Wight Sustainable Transformation Partnership and the Dorset Integrated Care System. We've got a Wessex Vaccine Trials senior project support helping us with logistics, HR, bringing people from the NHS. We've got over 400 volunteers across Dorset and Hampshire from the NHS prepared to do extra shifts and time on the vaccine hubs and from colleagues in primary care. Southampton are the lead contracting trust because it's just too complicated to do this in more than one organisation. But we've had to resolve all sorts of issues from governance, because normally trusts are independent legal organisations doing vaccine trials. So it's absolutely brilliant collaboration that we've been able to contract centrally from Southampton, but actually deliver in multiple sites. And we opened the Novavax trial at the Dorset Hub in Bournemouth last week, supported by staff from Bournemouth, Southampton and across the Wessex region. And that's recruited over 130 people so far, and it will recruit probably 120 to 150 people per week until we reach our target in a few weeks' time, which is yet to be established whether it's 500 or 700 people. So enormous activity. Will then be opening the new site in Southampton in mid-November, and either the AstraZeneca antibody or Janssen study will be the first studies through that site. So if you want to know, the next question people ask is when are we going to get the vaccine with all this trial work? The answer to that is, we still don't know. Any of these trials could fail at any time, and you'll have seen the well-publicized safety pauses in the press. This is completely normal for adverse events in trials to cause a pause. You normally don't notice that, but because this is such high profile, these safety reviews have made the national press. But we think there might be possible deployment on conditional approval for the highest risk groups, and that means the elderly, in early 2021, where the risk benefit of not knowing everything about the vaccines will be probably in favour of giving early approved vaccines to a population who otherwise have an extremely high mortality. Will we get mass immunisation in 2021? Nobody would put money on this happening before July, and it's probably going to be in autumn or later in the year, next year, before there's genuine mass immunisation of young people, young adults, as well as the elderly or at-risk people. If you're interested in that, there's a COVID-19 Search for a Vaccine podcast. I think I'm on next week's episode with Kate Bingham, who's the chair of the Vaccine Task Force, and others. But there are some really interesting episodes before that of how the Vaccine Task Force have gone about their work. So finally, I just thought I'd show you a little video that encompasses a lot of the clinical research or the spectrum of clinical research that's happened in Southampton, the clinical research we've done at the hospital. And this has encompassed vaccines, new therapies, and rapid diagnostics. And I'll hand back to Zoe as soon as the 2-minute video has finished.
Researchers at University Hospital Southampton have appealed for healthy volunteers to take part in trials of a potential vaccine against the coronavirus. It could be underway later this week.
Trials for a vaccine which could protect against COVID-19 is set to begin across Southampton.
We are seeing experimental
as well as the safety and the immunology, and whether the vaccines are boosting the immune system against COVID, but also whether it's working as the lockdown ends to actually stop people getting COVID.
We were lucky enough to be in a position, because of my previous research, to start a trial for COVID point of care testing in our emergency department and medical admissions unit. We're now moved into using that test as a routine diagnostic in our acute areas.
And on the coronavirus trial, the 600 patients in Southampton, I'd just like to thank you very much.
Well, my message today is thank you very much, because the way that vaccines are going to come through this is obviously through clinical trials now.
It's not just vaccine trials, it's all trials. And actually Southampton has a real record of citizens taking part in trials, in studies, and this is the way medicine progresses, not just for coronavirus, but generally. So an enormous thank you for the whole of what people are doing to volunteer.
Thank you so very much to Professor Saul Force there. Wow, what an evening of incredible talks we've heard this evening. We're going to try and whip through as many of your questions as we can. Thank you so much to everyone. It's been fantastic to see the hundreds of you here, and so much interest in what everybody had to say this evening. So let's see how many of these we can get to. I'm going to start with a question for Dr. Ken Braxton from James Batchelor. He says, do you think the statistics of social media use is an indicator of concern about COVID?
I think that's a very good question. And I do think that the social media statistics are a cause for concern. I think there's a lot of false information flying around all over the place about COVID, and some of them, as you know, are conspiracy theories. And I think people tend to be more outspoken on social media regarding their attitude. I think the keyboard warriors, I think they're called. So they do have a platform for which to voice their opinions, which are not all the time correct. Now, this was a big survey that we put out, and there was a lot of data that we collected. Now, one of the questions that we included in the survey was, from which sources do you typically receive new information about COVID-19 from? And if I remember the data correctly, the top three sources where people pick up facts and bits of information about COVID were WhatsApp groups, Facebook and Twitter. And given the amount of time that people spend on social media, it is a problem. I don't think there's necessarily very much we can do about that. But the good thing also is that there are plenty of good things that are being shared, so informative things that are also funny, which I think is a really good combination. So I saw a video yesterday of a song from Beauty and the Beast, the Disney cartoon. I think it was made into a COVID wear a mask type song, and it's been shared by millions of people. So it's a bit of a double-edged sword. I could probably talk about the psychology of social media all night. So an answer to that question, yes and no.
Thank you very much, Ken. I'd like to throw this to Nisreen as well. You have an interesting perspective on social media, don't you?
Well, yeah, I think so. Yeah.
Yeah. Sorry. I just want to bring some positivity in saying that social media can also be positive, like Ken pointed out. In the story of long COVID, social media has been really a massive, massive power. First of all, when nothing was there, people were supporting each other just by sharing their account of not recovering. And that was quite powerful, certainly from my experience. That was the only source to actually see other people experience the same thing. Otherwise, it can be very frightening, you know, not getting better. But also the others, you know, and then people came together and then now we've got these massive, in the spring, started these massive social support groups. So at the moment, the Facebook, the UK long COVID support group has got almost 25,000 people. You know, there are big support groups elsewhere on Facebook and on Slack channels. So it's, and they drove the long COVID agenda. They actually put the questions on the table. They drove the action from scientists, from the politicians. So it's been positive in that sense.
Thank you very much. I've got a few questions for Jessica Floyd about this idea of synchronized cycles, if you like, of lockdown across Europe. Thank you to Catherine de Retuerto, Francesca Barnes, Jonathan Houghton. They want to know, could it work? Are we able to collaborate enough to do it? Could it work at a national level in the UK? There's lots of interest around that.
Yeah. Thanks for the questions. Could it work across Europe? I don't know if I'm qualified to answer that sort of thing, but it definitely would be better. Whatever coordination we can get, I think, would be better than no coordination or just small levels of coordination in little pockets. In terms of the UK, when these analyses were conducted, the case numbers were very high, the R number was very high, and because testing capacity was lower, we didn't know as much about what numbers look like in particular regions. But now that we know exactly where and when cases are occurring and what regions and areas have particularly high levels of cases, it makes more sense to target interventions and lockdowns to those areas. But I would say it's still definitely important to coordinate, and I think the Prime Minister actually mentioned something about that today, coordinating lockdowns so that all areas with high numbers of cases are seeing similar restrictions.
Thank you very much, Jessica. I've got a question from Mark Spearing for Paul Elkington. He says, knowing what you know now, if you were to start again, are there things you would have done differently in the first few days and weeks? And he also says, congratulations on the MBE, well deserved.
Well, thanks. Well, the MBE is for the whole team, both in the university, hospital and wider Southampton. What I didn't realise, I mean, we thought it was a great idea, but what I didn't realise is the regulators will only discuss once you've passed the regulatory hurdle. So we spent an awful lot of time lobbying the NHS and government. And in actual fact, what we should have done is we should have invested that in effort in taking the respirator. And probably I would have gone to European testing houses to get it tested faster, as well as going through the UK testing houses. And then once we've got that regulatory approval, start lobbying the process. But it was a chaotic time, I think, for many people.
Thank you very much, Professor Elkington. I've got a question here for Dr. Michael Head. Is the main reason we don't fund research in advance a political decision or a scientific one?
I think it's very much what we might call a systemic thing. It's a bit like trying to turn an oil tank around. It takes a lot of effort and a lot of time. I think in the last few years, there has been a bit more both political will and scientific will to do so. We've, for example, had the setup of an organisation called CEPI, C-E-P-I, And they've been awarded a lot of funding from multiple donors to try to look at the horizon scanning side of things and develop new therapeutics and new vaccines against potential threats. As we've seen, it wasn't quite set up soon enough. If it had been in 5 to 10 years' time that this pandemic had emerged, we might actually have been in a better position because of the CEPIs of this world. So I think that both the political inclination and sort of the World Health Organization and other stakeholders that were starting to kind of view pandemic planning as more important, but the pandemic got here a bit too soon. But hopefully we don't lose the sort of the memory of what it's been like across 2020 and probably across 2021 as well in future years, to make sure that we do kind of retain the clear need to plan for this sort of thing in advance better in the future.
Thank you. I've got another question here for Jessica Floyd from Konstantinos Regas. He says, why was the lockdown in England only half as effective as the one in France?
Okay, yeah, so that's from that map that I had of all of movement reductions across Europe, and it was there were more reductions in France in movement than in England. And that's because that map was a snapshot of that week at the end of March, and I think at that point England and the UK had only just implemented lockdown, whereas France had been going for quite a few weeks longer. So it was seeing much stronger, lower levels of movement there.
Thank you. Sorry, I've muted myself a bit too prematurely there. Thank you very much, Jessica. Now, I've got a question here. I'm going to throw this open. We've had a couple of people asking about some research involving Synergen and some trials. I wonder if possibly Paul, Professor Elkington, you could start by telling us what that was.
So that trial was nebulized interferon beta, which was referred to in the clip. And so interferon beta activates your cells to fight off virus, and Synergen has developed it for other viral infections and has done a small trial which has shown some initially exciting positive results, but it needs to be confirmed in a larger trial. So I think some of the questions are revolving, why haven't we heard more of it? We can only be absolutely sure it works when it's been done in the bigger cohort. And I think one of the things which we've learned from the coronavirus outbreak is, you know, President Trump was taking hydroxychloroquine saying it was great, and then the clinical trials showed it made no difference. And so we have to go through things properly. And if we cut corners, then there is a risk that treatments which don't work as well as the initial studies claim are then used inappropriately.
Thank you. And then a final question for Michael Head from Alan Stevens. He says, so being proactive, what does horizon scanning suggest is coming next? Crystal ball time.
Well, I think we all probably assumed it would be flu for the kind of the next great big pandemic. So I think we the kind of sort of global health, we got caught out somewhat by that. I think essentially viral respiratory ticks all the boxes in terms of a global pandemic. Things like Ebola are clearly very scary, and they can cause big multiple country outbreaks, as we saw in West Africa a few years back. But in terms of a global pandemic from Ebola, that's very unlikely. It doesn't transmit as easily as something like a respiratory illness. So we're looking at things like the coronaviruses and the flus for the probable next pandemic. But again, the horizon scanning in terms of viruses we don't yet know of yet. That's something we're going to have to look at over the sort of the next few years, next decade or two, just to see what might be there that we haven't seen so far.
Thank you very much. Well, I'm afraid we're out of time now, so it just remains for me to thank all of our speakers this evening, Dr. Ken Braxton, Dr. Peter Lawrence, Professor Paul Elkington, Professor Sol Forst, Dr. Michael Head, Dr. Nizreen Alwan, and Jessica Floyd. And thank you very much for everyone who's joined us this evening. I don't know about you, I've learned an awful lot, and it is really fantastic to be able to get all of these experts together to hear individually from them about their research. So thank you.